Good morning, my dear friends. Glad to be here on day two, and thanks for joining us back on day two. The five kleshas or afflictions which cause these five types of vrittis to be painful or impression building are these five, right? Ignorance, desire, aversion, highness, and fear. So let us quickly look at it. I mean, that was a summary of what we covered yesterday, but I want to dive in a bit more on the afflictions before we go into the rest of the topics. So these afflictions are also called kleshas in Yoga Sutras, right? And then in fact, someone had this acronym of FIELD. So fear, ignorance, ego, like and dislike. Raga, dvesha is between likes and dislikes. Ashmita is the ego, avidya is ignorance, and then abnivesha is fear. And these are the three key afflictions that color our thoughts. If you have thoughts without these afflictions, then they are okay. Though they become impressions in the mind. But these five afflictions are what causes pain, causes suffering. Right? These five afflictions are what make the vrittis painful. And the whole idea of yoga is to make sure the vrittis shouldn't be there, and then even the vrittis are there, they shouldn't be colored with the five afflictions. All right, so here is a wheel of suffering I pulled up from good source. So if you look at it, let's start from the right, where it says perception. So what does the mind do? We perceive things as we see, as we hear, as we smell, as we touch, as we taste, right? We see. So the first set of information comes in through the senses. So the sense organs perceive, and then they translate into sensation in our nervous system. And then the brain and the nervous system act in accordance to color that particular thought or the sensation into a feeling or an emotion, right? Energy in motion is emotion. So it colors that through emotion, and then according to neuroscience, there are related chemical changes that happen, which, for example, if you're afraid, if you suddenly get afraid of something, or maybe fear. Let's assume going in front of a stage and talking to an audience, you're afraid. So the fear generates a certain set of chemicals like cortisol, which is more the stress causing chemical. So then appropriate glands open it, and then you feel butterflies in your stomach, right? So you feel afraid in your stomach area. So you feel the emotion of fear translating to your body. Right? So all that is caused by the brain and the nervous system. And the way it happens is, according to yogic science, is those feelings then get, why a particular feeling gets colored with a particular klesha or an affliction is what yoga is about, yogic science is about, right? So you look at this towards the left, you see, so once I have a feeling, so those feelings are either colored because I like something, I don't like something, and I'm afraid of something. Right? And the cycle here talks about everything. There are things that either you like or not like, right? And as this chart says, I like that or I dislike that. And there is the I part of it, which is what is the ego, abnivesha. Sorry, asmita. So there is this I, me and mine, which is my identity. I like it because something that I like, someone else may not like. Something that someone else likes, a third person may not like. So that is dependent on the identity. So that identity is the ego. And then why does the ego really care about all these likes and dislikes and different colors? It's because it has a fear of death. The ego has this fear of death, and that is why it's hold on. It colors all these emotions that way. That is because the ego doesn't see life as life should be seen. Right, not seeing things, that is ignorance. So that is the whole cycle. All these five kleshas participate in this whole cycle of perception to response to action. And along that part is where the physical body, the brain, the endocrine glands and nervous system participate. It also has an impact on the pranic system, right? So for example, when you are afraid, your heart kind of starts pumping blood a lot, right? So all those changes happen, and then it results in some action. And that action coming out of klesha, coming out of one of these five, if any action happens, action could be thought, word, or actual doing action. Anything that arises from the kleshas is colored, and that causes something called a samskara. Right? That's what we learned yesterday. So here is, I want to kind of dwell a bit more onto this vritti samskara chakra. So I did mention this is what is vritti samskara chakra. So what it means is, again, the cycle can start from anywhere to anywhere. So we'll probably look at two such cycles, right? So we just mentioned how a sense perception translates into a samskara, right? And then and repetition of that particular cycle constantly stores that particular or records the particular experience in the chitta. That is the recording that happens. That's what is there in chitta, right? So anything that keeps continuously happening, is creates a stronger impression on the chitta. And those are termed as samskaras. For example, yesterday we spoke about that example of fear. Let's say you have this, let's say someone has this feeling of having this lack. Someone has this feeling of not having enough, irrespective of whatever they are having. That comes from a samskara, right? And what happens, anything that they want, that is why you'll see some of the folks who are really rich, really super rich, right? Even they will resort to things like stealing things from somebody, or maybe stealing power from somebody. So the stealing part is going to be common. What they do from others is different, right? So they might be abundant, but they'll have that particular sensation or feeling. So that is samskara. So impression stored in the consciousness is from there it becomes samskara, then the vasana, vritti, dvesha, right? So there are two points I want to convey here. We just spoke about how a sense perception creates a samskara. Repeated occurrence of the particular samskara gets imprinted real strong, and that becomes a vasana. And then vasanas get carried from birth to lifetime to lifetime. On the converse, on the reverse, right? You might be seeing some people are always brooding. We covered that yesterday. Always brooding, always thinking of, hey, I don't have enough, always complaining, right? And then sometimes you would wonder, where did it come from? Where does this come from, right? So that comes from the vasanas. Some people are always aggressive. Some people are very arrogant, right? I mean, even in the same house, the same household, same family, two siblings, one person will be a diametrically opposite of the other person. How did that happen? It's not about the upbringing. It's not about genes, right? So that is the nature of the vasanas that they have brought in from a previous lifetime. We'll cover the gunas part of it towards the end of the talk today. All right. So anything very similar. Some people will be very daring, very courageous. Some people will be very afraid to do anything. Some people will always be dull. They wouldn't want to do anything. Some people's mind is always disturbed, always scattered. They cannot focus. So all that is coming from the vasanas and the samskaras of the past life. And then as we continue to live through, there are things that keep getting added. There are things that keep getting added if they don't get through a process of yoga. So that is the vritti samskara chakra. Again, there are different terms. There was a question yesterday on samskaras, vasanas, and then there is pretty much in English we call this as tendencies. So one of the term is referred to as the imprint that's stored in the consciousness, and the vasanas are the fragrance, they are the tendency to color a thought based on a particular samskara, right? So you don't need to worry too much about the terminology, but the point is we create those samskaras, we create those imprints, that is the whole thing. And anything that we create, the affliction that we create, are the ones that cause us pain, that are the ones that cause the disturbed mind, the distracted mind, and the dull mind. So moving on, so we've seen how the lake, we took the metaphor of the lake, we've seen how the lake, when it's colored, clouded, and it is too rough with waves, it's very difficult to see the bottom of the lake, which is our true nature, right? And a wonderful analogy from Swami Vivekananda. So now, how to become free from the samskaras or kleshas? We spoke about two things. Patanjali talks about two major solutions. Number one is, as you, just like what we normally do, right? I mean, a positive with a negative or a negative with a positive. So even here, we can prevent afflictions arising by substituting it with a higher level helpful intention, right? If you are fearful, then you'll have to kind of substitute with something very strong. And then I also talked about how if a certain level of goal is not, if certain level of goals are not really helpful, then we'll have to kind of look at the higher level goals as a purpose for us to make sure the lower level goal is kind of part of something else, right? And similarly, anything that to do with desire, likes and dislikes. So that's where we talk about, okay, so it doesn't really matter whether you like something, but you also try something else. So replacing something with a higher level helpful intention. The second method is, as Patanjali says, dhyana heya stadvrittaya. The mental tendencies associated with afflictions can be destroyed by meditation. We'll see more about this. So just like the previous slide talked about, focus on cultivating helpful impressions, joy, peace, empathy, confidence. So when we do meditation, all of us know they are the ones, they by nature, they add such calming attributes or calming states, right? So joy, peace, empathy, confidence. So all that come in just because the kleshas that are causing pain get subdued. That's what we call by calming, right? Once they start calming, and it also get added, gets all the joy, peace, and all the other attributes get added as the other impressions. So they are positive impressions. They are not colored. So you increase the positive impressions. So that way these become stronger and your negative impressions are subdued. So that is what we call as calming. And the second part is meditation also allows you to be in a state where you don't create those karmic impressions again, right? That is because we are a lot more mindful, a lot more aware. So anytime you see something, oh, okay, then you go back and see that's what is stepping out of ignorance is. Okay, so I am not that person, right? So that particular, why am I getting that feeling? Why am I getting that sensation? Why am I getting the thoughts? So we're a lot more mindful and we consciously choose a painless way or a painless vritti than a painful vritti. So that is the second aspect of how, so meditation adds positive attributes, that way it subdues negative attributes, and then it also prevents us from creating newer negative attributes or negative thoughts, right? So that is a twofold advantage of a meditation practice. And again, the key here is we have to be really disciplined. It needs to be a very disciplined practice. And that's where the next aspect that Yoga Sutras emphasize is this sutra. It's called Abhyasa Vairagya Abhyan Tannirodaha. Abhyasa Vairagya Abhyan Tannirodaha, which means Abhyasa is practice, Vairagya is non-attachment. Right? These two are very important, and that is why In fact, there are quite a few sutras that talk about how should you do your practice. And the way we should do the practice is not giving up. How do we do the practice so that we don't give up? Most often than not, we've seen, we go to a yoga class, we go to a meditation class. That happens with physical exercises as well, where we get into a practice, we want to get started with something, and then over time, we stop doing it for various reasons. So there are several attributes that Yoga Sutras talk about how you need to do a practice. The foremost is enthusiasm, right? You need to have that energy. You need to be enthusiastic about doing that practice every day. And faith is another one. Consistency, courage, patience, focus, wisdom. Wisdom, it's like in doing the right things. So practice is the foundation for our transformation, right? Whatever we do, it could be, we'll talk about what the practice constitutes in a minute, but practice is all about consistency, enthusiasm. Again, we shouldn't be finding it dreary. Oh my God, I need to do this. That's what happens when we get into some of the strenuous yogic postures or exercises, right? But then there is a benefit to it. And we spoke about that a little bit on an example that I quoted from my personal experience yesterday. So practice is one. And then second is non-attachment. So consistent practice of meditation in this case, consistent practice of meditation allows the existing samskaras or vasanas to be subdued so that you keep cultivating that equanimity, keep cultivating joy that meditation brings you, and that is the state you are always in, right? When you do that, you can't be still going on to fearful, worrisome situations. You can't still be going into situations where you don't have clarity. You can't still be going to situations where you are embraced by fear, embraced by greed, embraced by self-identity. So even after doing meditation, if you're going and then feeling very bad about something someone has remarked about you, then there is work to do, right? So that is where the second aspect of this whole Abhyasa Vairagya, this non-attachment, comes in. And this is a foundational pillar for transformation through yoga, is non-attachment. So non-attachment to things, people, thoughts, emotions, ideas, and concepts. What is non-attachment is not detachment. It doesn't say you shouldn't have that wonderful car, you shouldn't have that wonderful house. It doesn't say you should have a wonderful, loving family, right? It's about the coloring of those lights. Once it becomes too strong for you to refute is when it becomes an attachment, right? So non-attachment is basically, okay, it's also another word for acceptance. To me, non-attachment also indicates acceptance, right? Whatever the situation may be, things come fine, it's okay. Things don't happen, it's okay. So for example, yesterday we did this whole session, and then I know there were a lot of audio issues, but thankfully there were some audio that was going through, and then you're able to hear, right? But then there's nothing to brood over, so you'll get a video recording of it, and I was able to kind of revise or recollect all the things that we spoke about yesterday, right? So we'll have to accept the situation, and I can't keep thinking, oh, I should have just done it from home, or I should have done it from a place like this in my office here. So it's acceptance. And similarly, there are a lot of situations that keep coming, life throws to us in a sense that we don't know how to react. So the main thing is acceptance. That is the core foundation pillar that I'm emphasizing here with yoga. Right? Non-attachment. See, non-attachment to things is very easy. Okay, so I have my laptop here, I have my iPad here. So tomorrow, someone might take it away, so I'm all open to it. Tomorrow the house may not be mine, I might tend to sell it, or whatever, the car may not be mine. So attachment to material possessions is probably very, it's gross, it's material. You can make an effort to it, right? Attachment to people, a little bit difficult. So that is the second part of it. What is the most difficult part is letting go of attachment to the concepts, to the beliefs that we have been ingrained with right from our birth. That is the biggest, that is the most difficult part of letting go. So the whole thing is about how do I let go of all those thoughts, beliefs that have been ingrained in me. And then sometimes we don't even realize, whenever anytime say non-attachment, we always look at material things or people. But the other things are very important. And of those concepts and ideas, right? I have an idea, I have a concept, this is how I want to go. That irrespective of how, whatever people say, I don't really care what they say, right? Some people are so focused on going forward with, again, that's also in part to their vasanas, which allow them to be overconfident, right? And in this case, maybe arrogant. So they don't listen to anybody. They say, this is what I want to do, right? Because of the influence of a lot of other factors. So letting go in that state needs a lot more compassion, needs a lot more understanding. So that is why Patanjali and in his Yoga Sutras clearly mentioned that as one of the key things that we need to practice in order to avoid accumulating our samskaras and accumulating vasanas and accumulating the impressions. So the practice strengthens the frame of mind so that existing samskaras don't come up, bubble up, and then color our thoughts and actions. And similarly, non-attachment prevents new samskaras and new impressions trying to get created, right? So these are the two key things that Patanjali starts off with when he talks about how do I avoid creating those karmic impressions. So, and then the Yoga Sutras clearly illustrate the obstacles or distractions to the mind waves which actually impact a practice. So definitely illness or disease is one where you can't do much about it, right? And then why is illness and disease caused? All these are kind of consequential. Why is illness is caused? Pretty much because of mental inertia. You are either stuck in something, either stressful, you're not able to think clearly, and your mind feels agitated, right? So that is another reason. Doubt. Okay, I'm doing meditation, or probably I'm doing some Hatha Yoga practices. I've been doing it for 2 months, nothing happened. Is this right for me? Is this not right for me? Right? So there is a doubt. Am I doing it right? How long should I sit and things like that, right? And then carelessness and apathy. Okay, so one day if we don't do it, that's okay. So that is one. Laziness is very similar. Sense cravings, again, all these practices, one of the key things of all these practices is moderation, right? So you cannot have a stomach load of food and that too more rajasic food and then go sit in meditation and then think that things will be fine, right? Or the same thing happens with yoga and exercise. So there is sense craving, too much of food, too much of entertainment, too much of WhatsApp, iPad, or WhatsApp, Facebook, right? So too much of that. Also, there's a lot of distraction that's happening. Your mind is restless. Confusion. Oh, I am following this meditation practice, but someone else said something else that worked out for him. So now you think about it, whether I should do it or not, right? Apathy we spoke about, and backsliding. See, some of these, a lot of people continue meditation. More often than not, there are two reasons for them to start meditation, right? One is either they're facing a lot of stressful situation, they have a problem to solve. And the second thing is they have a physical issue, right? Maybe some pain or whatever that they want to kind of fix. And that is what they start off meditation, right? Especially when they have those two small goals and then things don't happen the right way. What happens is they stop the meditation, right? So you continue for 40 days, you attend a meditation class and then stop meditating, or same thing, do another exercise. What happens? Again, your practice is broken, right? And that is what there are some institutions or traditions which say you have to continue for 40 days. If you break any time within that, you will restart the 40 days, right? So those are some of the tools or techniques that people follow to avoid backsliding. And all these obstacles or distractions to a practice and to your mind waves how do you see that? How does it manifest? How does it appear in our physical realm? Number one as pain. When you say pain, pain could be leading to illness, some kind of a pain, some kind of a mental pain, physical pain, right? So that is pain. And the second one is your pain here probably is physical. And then the mental agitation, right? Okay, I don't know whether I'm doing this or not. You're always disturbed and distracted. And then physical trembling. Patanjali talks about physical trembling also, right? So in terms of, okay, so I'm not doing this practice regularly either because of one of those reasons. So your body becomes weak because of some of those practices. And then same thing you do with erratic breathing. All these are interrelated. This is how you're able to see suddenly you feel your heartbeat goes up or goes down. And maybe you could relate it to blood pressure, right? So these are all these are how the obstacles manifest. If any of these happen, you'll have to trace it back to one of the previous seven. So 7 plus, 9 plus 4, 13 obstacles is what we need to be guarded of, is what is written in the Yoga Sutras, right? And what is the solution for getting over those obstacles and going through a constant practice? So Yoga Sutras talk about, again, these two key things. Number one, you need a strong one-pointed concentration on anything to avoid those obstacles, right? Your practice should involve one-pointed concentration. And concentration is all the mind, right? And we are talking about the mind, the vritti is related to the mind. So there should be some exercise of the mind, some training of the mind. And that training is concentration. So concentration is the best way to remove those obstacles. The second key point here, or the antidote here, is an attitude of compassion, right? And then the sutra below talks about that. Maitri, Karuna, Mudito, Pekshanam, Sukha, Dukkha, Punya, Punya, Vishayana, Bhavanatas, Chitta, Prasadanam. So Maitri, Karuna, Mudita, Upeksha. These are the four. In fact, there are also the Brahma Viharas, and it's called Brahma Viharas in Buddhist scriptures. Friendship, Maitri, Karuna is compassion. Mudita is happiness. And Upeksha is tranquility or equanimity. And then this is what it says, this whole sutta in one sutta, right? So friendliness, if you find someone happy, the attitude should be of a friendliness, not of envy. If you find someone miserable, the attitude should be of more of compassion, right? And again, if you find someone doing very good, very virtuous, very knowledgeable, doing all the noble deeds, you should be happy, feel happy for him rather than, hey, why is he wasting money or what is he doing, right? And the third one is for people who are not so good, people who are doing all the bad things, instead of you judging and feeling, the action here, you have to be equanimous. There's nothing that you could do about it. And then the only thing that you can do about is not judge and then create a samskara for yourself. Oh my God, he did this, and then create judge and create a samskara for that, right? So this is the attitude, primarily focusing on the different aspects of compassion. And then Yoga Sutras talk about the six key ways of developing concentration. It's called contemplation or meditation. Right? So the first one is controlled exhale and retention of the breath. It's a kind of a practice related to pranayama. So that is one technique where you continuously practice that will develop concentration. So that is number one. Or meditating on a subtle object that helps steady the mind. It could be any subtle object. Right? For us, we usually take the breath as the subtle object for us to focus on steadying the mind. The third method that Patanjali mentions here is focusing on the inner light, right? There are meditations that talk about you focus on the heart, see the light at the heart, or see the light at the forehead. So that is one method, one technique. The fourth technique is meditating on the picture or an object or the form of an enlightened master. Be one of the great yogis, one of the saints, right? So the idea is if you have that person as the object of meditation, you will get all the attributes and characteristics or the behaviors, the states of the particular master. So So that is why Patanjali mentioned that. The fifth one is focusing on the experiences during the dream-filled or dreamless sleep. There are a lot of people who kind of focus on that. The last one is on any object that uplifts us. And again, there are some criteria. It cannot be some any material object. So a lot of people use the heart as the area for them to meditate, right? Or they will say loving kindness, or they want to kind of think about compassion. So there are different kinds of meditation that allow us to focus on that as the object, right? So that there are, Patanjali lays down these six ways for anybody to develop concentration, develop one-pointed attention using any of these methods. And why are we doing it? So that is what develops the concentration, develops the concentration for continuously doing the practice as well. And the way most of us have been practicing breath meditation, right? So we've taken breath as that subtle object that helps study the mind. Sorry, I forgot to mention one. So on the last part, on any object that uplifts us is where all the mantra meditation comes in, right? So there is a sound or there is a mantra that you are given and you recite that mantra. So that is also kind of a japa, right? So that also develops concentration, right? And again, all these have certain stages. All meditations have some certain stages. These are the different milestones towards deep meditation. So when we all start meditating, usually it starts off with the concentration on the gross object. Gross object is your breathing, right? We say point your attention to your nose and feel the breath, feel the in-breath and out-breath. There are people who focus their attention on the heart, the people who focus an attention on a symbol or a mantra, right? People who focus an attention. So it starts off with the gross, your senses, your thought, thinks about that particular object. As we continue to do meditation, then slowly, if it is the mantra, we start focusing on the meaning of the mantra, the sound of the mantra, right? If it is breath, we start focusing on the sensation. So that is why we talk about focus on the breath, attention, and then focus on the sensations of the breath, which is more awareness, right? So awareness is subtle. Again, this is not something I made up, right? These are the four stages towards samadhi, or the total absorption part that has been documented in Yoga Sutras, right? So the second stage is when we start realizing the sensations, when we do the breath, and if it is any object, you'll go behind meaning of a mantra, the sound of a mantra, right? It's not just the gross object. And the third stage is when you start feeling ananda. There is this whole feeling of inner joy, correct? And that is the third stage, a third milestone in deep meditation. And then you'll get into a state where you start feeling yourself separate. You start feeling your mind. In fact, in breath mindfulness meditation, there are these four different stages. You start focusing your attention. The first technique or skill that we use is to start focusing attention on the breath. Right? So initially, it will be very sporadic attention, and then there will be continuous attention. Once we get to continuous attention, that is when you start feeling sensations. That is the awareness of the subtle, the second stage, right? And then once you start feeling sensations, one, the sensations or the energies, you start feeling that throughout your body, then what happens is that is the state when you get peaceful in your mind and start feeling the joyful sensations. Once you start feeling the joyful sensations, then you get into a totally absorbed state, totally peaceful state, totally thoughtless state. We talk about that, right? So, I mean, thought might be occurring, but you're not aware of it, and you're very, very conscious of the other part. And then during this time, you also see where thoughts are coming from. You know, when thoughts are coming, you are able to kind of disassociate yourself from that. So you're able to feel, okay, anytime you're getting a thought, you're aware of the thought, and then you're mindful of taking an action A or an action B. Going back to our earlier thing, right? So you're very mindful of not causing a colored thought or not causing a vritti with a klesha, right? So that is where you start feeling, oh, that is not me. I mean, that is my thought. That is my mind. That is not me. So that is the awareness of I-ness or thought itself, right? So again, four stages documented. Again, there are quite a few sutras that talk about the different aspects involved in the whole practice of trying to get into an absorption state. So what are the key requirements? So this is another popular sutra that talks about tapa svadhyaya ishvara pranidani kriya yoga. So what it means is kriya yoga. Before I talk about the rest of this thing, I want to kind of explain what is kriya yoga. So kriya yoga is yoga in action. There is another popular kriya yoga that has been taught or came out from the school of Paramahamsa Yogananda, Swami Paramahamsa Yogananda, right? So this is not talking about it. So this kriya yoga distinguishes this from karma yoga, bhakti yoga, and jnana yoga. So what this says is this is something not for yogis, not just for yogis. It's for all of us. And that means as you continue to act, yoga is not theory. So yoga is in action. So as you continue to live in this world, as we continue to perform action, is when this is applies. To do that union in action, you need three things. Number one is tapa, which relates to discipline, self-discipline. Second thing is svadhyaya, which is self-study. And third is Ishvara Pranidhana, which is more about faith and trust or surrender to a higher power or the higher intelligence that actually makes all this happen, right? So these three are the boundaries for our yoga practice. So we'll have to have discipline, self-discipline, and there are some things that we need to do. Self-discipline, there is self-study is basically about recollecting, okay, I did this, or being mindful of, okay, I had got these thoughts, I shouldn't have done that, right? And then I've been doing this meditation, so what else should I do? Have I added the compassion element, right? So there are all these elements that you need to keep studying. And that is what happens when we do meditation also. As we do meditation, we go inward, and we look at thoughts that are colored, and then it automatically gets removed, right? So meditation also is more an inward journey, and self-study allows you to kind of make sure your outward journey or your actions are in alignment with your inward journey. And overall, all of us need to have faith and trust, and then that is why that is the whole purpose of this master class, right? Whatever we talk about meditation, whatever we talk about happiness, they've all been documented in this 1500-year-old scripture. And the Yoga Sutras talk about multiple. Let's say, for example, in the earlier slide, we talked about six different ways of developing concentration. The whole idea is not everyone needs to take all the six. You need to take what works for you. And then later we'll talk about the eight limbs of yoga. So again, that some things work well for some people, but then everything needs to be done there. So that is there. And then this compassion element, right? So all there are different elements. You have to start with one, but continuously have faith in that and continuously repeat it for a long time and in a consistent manner. So that is the whole. So these are the boundaries of a yogic practice: discipline, self-study, and faith. Faith is very important, because especially when we see no results coming in, a lot of people say 2 months, 3 months, I've been meditating, nothing happens. Right? And then all of a sudden, one day, you'll just get into, you'll start feeling the meditative state, right? But then those 3 months are not a waste. And then I keep telling, right, any meditation that you do is not a bad meditation. The only bad meditation is the one that you didn't. So discipline, self-study, and faith are very important, right? So those are the requirements for the basic yoga or the solution that Yoga Sutras talk about. And then moving on to the eight limbs of yoga. So all of you might have heard about Ashtanga Yoga, Ashta Anga. Ang is limbs. Right? So the eight limbs to this yogic practice that has been prescribed in Yoga Sutras. In fact, I had another picture as well. So these eight limbs are not to be seen as a step by step in this picture. That's why I had another picture as well. So they are like together. They're almost like a circle. They're almost like a circle, right? So sometimes all of those happen simultaneously, ideally. And it's not that you follow the moral code first and the next step, right? So we'll have to be following all of them simultaneously. But the way it is depicted here is from the foundational element to the top one is probably most difficult part, and the foundational element probably easier. But for a lot of people, it will be other way around as well. So what are these eight limbs of yoga? So starting from the bottom, yamas are the restraints that we have to apply in our life, right? So again, this is like the moral science classes of our school. So being non-violent, non-lying, which is satya, or speaking truth, non-stealing, asteya, brahmacharya is moderation, non-waste of vital energies, and then aparigraha is the non-greed, not being greedy, right? So these are the restraints of you not doing something that will cause those afflictions and fluctuations of the mind or the mind waves. That is key here. And again, all these apply both to the gross materials, materialistic world, right? When you say stealing, it's not just about stealing someone's property or stealing someone's things, right? It's also about stealing thoughts. It's also about stealing ideas, right? It's also about stealing emotions. What do I mean by stealing emotions? Someone is feeling very angry because of the particular situation. Doesn't mean one should feel angry because of the same situation, stole an emotion, right? And moderation and all. Non-greed, again, it's not about accumulation, or not just accumulation of wealth. It's also accumulation of pain, accumulation of joy, right? Accumulation of knowledge. Everything needs to be at a moderate, balanced way. And I think we all know what is that middle path, right? So it's not this extreme or extreme. So you don't need to be amassing wealth for 100 generations, nor should you be totally disconnected or disattached from wealth. Right? It's the middle path. So that is the yamas, the restraints. Then we have niyamas, which are the observances. So they are purity. Purity in thought, purity in actions, purity in words. There is contentment, gratitude. A lot of us do this gratitude practice. I'm happy, I'm glad, I'm grateful for all that we do. So there's thankful. We are always thankful for everything. So that is a gratitude practice. And then the other three are the elements we just talked about. For the reason that they are really important, Patanjali mentioned that before as well, right? Tapas, Swadhyaya, and Ishvara Pranidhana. So Swadhyaya is self-study, those are the benchmark. You continuously keep evaluating and then being mindful of what you do. And if there are some afflictions that are still happening, you need to figure out why is it happening. For example, you'll always see people wanting to try different things. They will try this, then after 2 months or 3 months, they'll say, no, I don't want to do this, I want to do something else. And then they'll try that for some time. So there are people who kind of jump from one task or one activity to another, right? And there are other people who are always indecisive. And then there are some people, okay, I've done everything, I don't need to do anything. So they are like more tamasic, right? So they are more laid back, I don't want to do anything, right? So all these are the effect of our samskaras and vasanas, right? Either we develop during this lifetime or develop later, right? And those all come from not adhering to one of these yamas and niyamas. So those are the yamas and niyamas, and asana, postures, and most of the practice, for example, even in meditation, you need to sit together for a long time for a practice, right? And it could also apply to other practices. So there are these asana postures. And as I said, in Yoga Sutra, there are only two sutras which talk about asanas, Sthira Sukham Asanam and the explanation of that. Right, so that's why we sit very in a relaxed posture, and that is asana. And then pranayama, there are five or six types of pranayama or breath control exercises that Yoga Sutras talk about, and then any pranayama teacher or a book will tell you those different breath control exercises that kind of regulates the flow of energy in the pranic body, and then because of that there might be an impact in the mind. The last four are completely to do with mind. The first two are related to different sense organs. Both the sense organs and the organs of action. So yamas and niyamas are related to that. So that is tending to the physical body. And even asanas are tending to the physical body. So we spoke about that yesterday. Pranayama is pretty much focused on the pranamaya kosha or the energy body. And then pratyahara, dharana, dhyana, samadhi. All these are related to the mind. And again, if you look at, I mean, that also illustrates the focus. All this time, whenever we talk about Yoga Sutras, it's all about the mind, right? The different states of mind, the fluctuations, how do you control afflictions, and everything is about how do you control that so that you reduce the noise in the mind, you remove the impurities, you remove the colors of the mind so that your body is associated with the our bliss or our wisdom body, right? So that is all. So pratyahara, dharana, dhyana, and samadhi. So these are the four key things that we combine all that into what we call as meditation or a concentration practice. So pratyahara is sense withdrawal. So the bottom three, right? Yamas, niyamas, and asanas deal with more of the senses and the organs. Pranayama moves a little bit subtler away from the physical body onto the energy body, which is more breathing. And then pratyahara is now saying shut off all your senses, now go inward. So the yamas, niyamas, asana, and pranayama help you in the outward journey. It makes your body fit, energetic, enthusiastic to kind of drive your outer purpose, right? It allows you to do the actions that your mind decides very well. Pratyahara is going inward. There's a sense withdrawal, that is when you grow. When all the senses are cut off, your mind doesn't get any sense information, and it stays there, right? And it allows it to focus on an inward journey. So pratyahara is sense withdrawal. Dharana is focus. That's what we start doing, focusing our attention on the breath, continue to focus attention on our breath. And then we get into this meditative state, which is continuous attention or continuous focus on the breath. And we went through those four stages of meditation, right? So from the gross to the subtle to the bliss or the ananda, and then looking at the attachment. So we get into more like a witness state. So dhyana is where you're witnessing your thoughts, you're witnessing your feelings, you're witnessing your mind, and then you're witnessing that thing that is watching the mind as well. Right, so that those are the different types of things that happen during dhyana. And once all this is done, the resulting state, the absorption, state of absorption is what is samadhi. And that is the highest degree of absorption. And then that is when, and again in samadhi, Yoga Sutras talk about different types of samadhi. There's something called nirbija samadhi, which is seedless, and there's something called seedful samadhi. Samadhi with seed, the seed is basically the kleshas or the impressions that carry on, right? So there is one absorption where still the past impressions are there, and the next stage of samadhi is even those past impressions are cleared. And the way to clear all those is through the mind, and getting the mind to do all that is where you need the foundational elements. That is how this picture is set up, right? But having said that, if you are doing meditation the way we normally do, it involves asana, pranayama, pratyahara, dharana, dhyana, and samadhi. Dhyana. And then the resulting state is samadhi, right? Meditative state. And then what happens when we do? The reason we do top down is when we do that meditation, it's easier for us to reduce our sense cravings. It's easier for us to not think about being greedy or not think about getting something from someone, right? So that is what meditation allows you to do. Meditation calms the mind, because the realization here is the mind is what allows your actions, influences your action to be violent, to be stealing something of someone, right? To be doing some things in excess. So the mind is what dictates that. Now with meditation, we're starting with the mind and then allowing you to focus. So there are two modes, right? You come top down from meditation, which influences the rest. to me, and I think so most of us, once you master meditation, it's a lot more easier because you don't need to be conscious of not thinking about some thoughts and all that stuff all the time. Meditation automatically calms things down, and then you get into that mode of a meditative state. Okay, so Yoga Sutras pretty much gives you why we are what we are, and it gives us all the pains, the way pains are created. It gives us all the solutions. It explains the ideal state that we have to be in. So it has all the knowledge that we've been craving for, right? In our quest to be happy, to be peaceful. And it essentially makes us be the driver of our life. When we say us, when it is you, it's the you, the being part of human being, like we spoke about yesterday. Human is the more mind-driven part of us. Being is more the intelligence and wisdom-driven part of us. So we have to be in control of our lives, not our emotions, not our thoughts, not our samskaras, not our vasanas, not the person next to you, not your parents, not your friends, not your spouses, not your kids, not your company, not your boss, not your friends. It's about you being in control of your life. And Yoga Sutras offers all those tools, which again centers on the practice of meditation. Meditation is nothing but training the mind. So with all these tools, you can be the driver of your life. And that is the purpose. That is the purpose of all of us incarnated in this world. So each of us have an outer purpose and an inner purpose. Our inner purpose is about realizing our true nature, which is, like I mentioned yesterday, we have the physical body, we have the mind, and then we have the true nature or the potential or the wisdom. So you have to collapse the body and the body system and our wisdom system, right? Without the mind. And that is what we talked about, a couple of metaphors yesterday in terms of the lake. The lake needs to be calm for us to be realizing this. And that is what Yoga Sutras is about. That is what meditation is about. That is what yoga is about. And similarly, the other metaphor is kind of removing all the colored lenses that our mind has. Once we remove it, we are united, right? And that is the whole purpose of life. And that is what we know as people talk about realization. We talk about self-realization. We talk about awakening. We awaken to our innate wisdom. We awaken to the power in us, right? Self-realization, awakening, enlightenment. There is light in each of us, but only thing we don't know. So that is enlightenment. So all that is, they are not the goals of monks in the Himalayas. They are the goals that each of us need to achieve. And that is what life is about. So that is one part of the life. And then there is an outer purpose, which all of us are destined to live. And coincidentally, Yoga Sutras also talk about that in terms of our samskaras, our vasanas, shaping the outer purpose as well. For example, yesterday I alluded to that. Someone who's been exposed to a great singer yearns to be another great singer, right? And then he probably learns the skills, he learns whatever is possible in his lifetime. But if he is unable to achieve or accomplish that particular goal for whatever reason, those samskaras, those imprints of those musical skills continue to be with them, and they continue to carry over to a subsequent lifetime. And that is what, as I mentioned yesterday, you see child prodigies, child geniuses who are very skilled in either math or some creative work, dance, music, singing. So how do they know which probably a 60-year-old person after 30 years of practice is not able to sing the same as a 6-year-old or a 5-year-old? So the point here is each one of us have some kind of a skill that we bring with us into this world. That's another insight from Yoga Sutras, right? And again, as part of our modern new age journey, we try to go and try to see what the strengths are. And more often than not, we forget what those strengths and skills are and then start looking at what the mind is directing us towards. And lot of times we fail in doing something that our mind wants just because we are not born for that. We are not skilled for that. We don't have that skill or potential. So the outer purpose of life, again, according to Yoga Sutras and yogic science, is to use our innate skills, innate potential, innate strengths for the betterment of everyone, for the being useful. In short, it is about being useful to others, using the skills and potential that you have. And the key trick here is how do you identify the skills and potential that you have, right? There are different ways. Modern psychology studies have several assessments that allow you to go and look at what your strengths are. For example, my strengths are writing. My strengths are, I'm good at creativity, right? So these are something that I uncovered over several processes, right? And some of you might have heard about this thing called VIA Strength Finder, VIA Strength Finder. So if you go search, it provides you a list of questionnaires. It tells you the five signature strengths, like creativity, leadership. It has, I think, close to 24 odd strengths, and it categorizes it. It's a free assessment. If you go take that, it'll give you a set of five signature strengths and then explanations, detailed explanations about it. So that is one kind of a tool. And there are several tools available there, right? In some cases, you recollect and retrospect in terms of what is it that you've been good when you are young before your mind took over and start honing the skills on. So what yogic scientists tell you is you have the highest degree of success in those innate skills that you are born with. Anything that your mind says you have to be that other person, you have to be like that because of society, because of this thing, you need to put in a lot more effort to succeed at that, and you need to bear the pain and frustration of not achieving that as well. So that discovering that outer purpose also happens when our mind becomes calm. That outer purpose completely depends on our skills, our potential. So now, the other question is, what is this game of life, right? Why are we born with a purpose, something to be done, and then there is whole mind thing, mind waves coming and obscuring that, the ego coming and obscuring that, and we have to go through a self-realization journey to understand our outer purpose and realize our inner purpose. What is this game? What is this play? Right? And that is where the concept of, it's what we call as play of gunas. So all of us, Yoga Sutras again talks about quite a bit of this, another insight. So as I mentioned earlier, some of us, there are people who always brood, there are people who always arrogant, there are people who are always joyful, there are people who are always lazy. Why is that? That is because of the nature of the gunas. Each of us are composed of these, one or more of these three gunas. Sorry, all the three gunas, but a different composition, right? There is this guna, sattva, rajas, and tamas. Rajas, people who are very aggressive, very arrogant, have a preponderance of the rajas guna or the attribute. People who say, okay, this is what happens in life. I'm not energetic, right? I mean, that is fine. I'll accept whatever it takes, right? It's not equanimity. It's not non-attachment, right? So they resign to life, and that is what is tamas. It's inertia, inactivity, negative. Why does it happen to me? Whatever I do doesn't work. So why should I do? Anything I do, I feel dull, I feel sleepy. So that's the preponderance of tamasic guna. And a balanced state is what is sattva, right? Balance, harmony, positive, peace, clarity. That sattva guna is what allows us to connect to our inner wisdom. So all of us are born with different gunas and different lifetimes. That depends on our, that also kind of tells us the purpose. And as Western psychologists and personal development masters talk about getting out of your comfort zone, right? Actually, yogic tradition, yogic wisdom talks about dwell in your comfort zone. When they say comfort zone, dwell in your comfort zone, it's not the mind created comfort zone, right? So we have some innate skills. Yesterday we spoke about those moments when you are connected, those moments when you are completely engrossed, those moments when you are completely in a wow, those moments of spontaneity. That is your real comfort zone, right? That is where your skills are. For me, for example, writing is when I get into the state. Presenting is when I get into that state. So my skills and my potential lie in that space. Similarly, for someone else, it could be sport, someone could be music, someone could be creating technology wonders. So that the purpose of life is kind of discovering that, what is the skills, what is that. And predominantly that is aligned to our gunas, sattva, rajas and tamas, right? And these three gunas play at different levels at different points of our life. And why does it happen? Why does life happen? Why do we come in and go through this whole dance of these gunas? Yoga Sutras talk about this concept of, I'm just taking two Sanskrit words, Purusha and Prakriti, the higher self and nature. Prakriti is nature. So there is this play between our real self and nature. Right, so nature is all these wonderful things, wonderful material things, and when we are born with that set of gunas, we are attracted to a lot of things, and then we get deviated probably, and then we get on to an inward journey. We are more focused on the outward journey and less on the inward journey, and that is where we tend to be a deviator. Right, this whole process of inner journey is about bringing you back, bringing Purusha and Prakriti together, and that is what is Samadhi, that is what is Kaivalya, the last chapter of Yoga Sutras. We're not going to talk about that, but that is the goal, right? So yeah, let me give you an analogy or a metaphor here, right? So we all know we have these resort chains. I'm a member of Club Mahindra. Club Mahindra has tons of resorts. And we go to a particular resort. We stay there for a few days. And the idea is to go stay there, relax, have a good time, and then get back home. But when I go to a particular resort, let's say Goa, there are a couple of good things that I am attracted to. And I develop a longing. Oh man, the water is so wonderful. The beach side is so great. Right? So I get attracted. There are those samskaras, there are those attractions that I develop. And what happens next time when I come back home, 6 months later when I want to take a vacation, what would I prefer? I prefer to go back to the same place. Right? So similarly, the reason we incarnate again and again, again as per yogic science, is that attraction, that samskaras that are good that we bring in here. Right, so Upanishads talk about several worlds. One of the world is the earth plane, just like one of the resort. So we happen to come here to enjoy the play of gunas, enjoy the play of Purusha and Prakriti. But when we happen to accumulate samskaras, when we happen to get attracted to some stuff here, cultivate likes and dislikes, desires, aversions, all those five kleshas, then we create those samskaras. So we come back again to clear those off. The two ways to clear those off, to live it or live it in the sense, accept, not cause further samskaras, or clear that through some of the yogic practices, right? And one of the samskaras, the set of samskaras are tied to our potential. We are supposed to come here. Just like, for example, taking the singing, I probably learned singing, but I'm not able to, I've not completed my quest or my realization through swings, through singing. So again, I come back, I am born into a particular place, a particular house and a particular resort, right? I'm born into that where my upbringing will allow me to unravel my potential. If I want to become a wonderful cricketer, I'd probably be born in that kind of a family which allows my skill to be grown, right? Which allows my potential to be realized. And then I flourish, and then my skills flourish, and that is again realization. Once I do that, all my fluctuations, all my samskaras related to that particular purpose gets resolved, right? So these three are the reasons why life exists, why we reincarnate. And again, quite a few of those are listed in the last two chapters of Yoga Sutras. Vibhuti Pada is more about what happens when you realize your true potential, right? And there are a lot of other powers that you get. And then the Kaivalya Pada is about the whole, what is this final state, why life happens, is Purusha and Prakriti, dance or play of the gunas, and a lot of this. We're not going to go in there. We have a lot of work to do prior to that. Let's get there. Let's get to the first milestone and then think about the other two. A quick note on the third chapter, which is Vibhuti Pada. Vibhuti Pada, as I said, is more than prasadam. So there are different techniques. Once we master meditation, right? The first chapter of Yoga Sutras, the first part of Yoga Sutras is Samadhi Pada, which talks about everything at a high level, brushes you through what Yoga Sutras are about, what is the state you need to achieve. The second part of chapter is Sadhana Pada. Today we covered most of that in terms of the practices, the bounds of practice, the non-attachment piece, and then the eight limbs of yoga, different types of meditation that it all talks about. And interestingly, it leaves the last three limbs, which is Dharana, Dhyana, and Samadhi, into what is called as Samyama. They are part of the third chapter, because deep meditation gets you access to infinite powers, or our special powers, which are called siddhis. There are quite a few siddhis that are being listed again in each of the sutras. If you do this, you do that. For example, there is a meditation, there is a samyama. If you focus on the pit of your throat, you will not feel hunger or thirst. So that's one siddhi that you develop because of that meditation. And there is another deep absorption. When I say meditation, let me just say it's samadhi, it's samyama, it's deep absorption. That's what our ancient rishis and munis have developed, right? And there are, as you continue doing meditation, there's another power or another siddhi that allows you to do remote viewing, right? You must have heard of yogis or people who stay in one continent but are able to see or able to talk about what's happening in another. Similarly, there is a power of clairvoyance. Similarly, there is a power of levitation. You must have heard all these from all these yogic stories. So Patanjali has written about those powers, and there is a technique for each of those. That is the essence of the Vibhuti Pada. And yeah, we are far away from that. And then for people who are interested in getting those, feel free to go through that chapter. But then Patanjali also closes everything, closes a particular thing with that. Whatever powers you have, again, they are all very, they can be used in a harmful way, they can be used in a peaceful way, right? So, and he cautions, there are at least three sutras that talks about cautioning the individual who has gained those powers to use that powers for ungainful activities, right? Or inappropriate activities. So that is the third piece. And the fourth one is the Kaivalya Pada, which is more about how emancipated person still lives and walks and works in this world without accumulating those samskara that we talked about. Okay, so finally I want to close this whole conversation, summing up into what are the three pillars for our personal transformation. We've been through this 2-day masterclass at a very high level. As I said, each of these, I mean, there are a lot of things that I deliberately not covered in the interest of time and also in the essence of what we wanted to cover, the key insights for people like you and me. So the three pillars of personal transformation are very simple: concentration, compassion, and non-attachment. We saw that concentration is dhyana, and dhyana clears a lot of those samskaras and impressions that we accumulated, and there's a whole process to it. There is science behind it, and we need to repose faith in it in terms of a regular practice. And that needs to be augmented with compassion. And we talked about 4, Maitri, Karuna, Mudita, and Upeksha. Right? These are the 4 compassion-driven activities we need to be practicing on a day-to-day life, again, by being mindful of what we do. And that also improves our social and relationships sphere in this world. And the third one we heard about, Vairagya, being unattached to the results, both in the practice as well as whatever we do. And being non-attached is that positive color or positive non-coloring, in contrary to the usual coloring that we do, right? Non-attachment and anything that we do, everything, all actions, words, and thoughts. And that is what I said, outer purpose is all about using our innate potential in being useful for the world, in being useful for others. It's not about being useful for you, which means again, you can continue the samskara cycle, right? So concentration, compassion, and non-attachment are the three pillars for personal transformation. And there are tools that are available for us to do. So we talked about meditation as a tool for developing concentration. And the second part is compassion. As you see, more traditions, schools of spirituality have this thing of seva or service, where you do selfless service, right? Where you do things without expecting returns. So it's about service, serving in a physical role, or serving, contributing monetarily, or even doing some kind of administrative work or a thought work, creative work for the mission. It could be to a specific institution, it could be for a cause, it could be for a mission, it could be for a going cleansing a society. So it could be for anything, but it's about spending time in that service, which is very important. The last part is being mindful of all our actions, all our thoughts, all our words, to ensure that we don't look forward to an outcome. And believe me, that is the biggest learning I've had from my study of Yoga Sutras, though I've been practicing the other two. But this whole non-attachment thing clears up a lot of stuff, especially at work. When you're trying to do something, we always think about, okay, what is it going to lead to? Will that be correct? Will I be right? Right? And then once this whole outcome, alignment with outcome, attachment to outcome goes away, you feel a lot more relieved. You feel a lot more still, which in turn adds to your creativity, which in turn adds to the focus, which in turn adds to your selflessness, right? Which makes that particular activity much more stronger, much more better. You do the right things at the right time, the outcome is guaranteed. That you don't, it's all about the process or the system, not about the result or the end goal. That's what yoga says, which most of us are science and neuroscience and psychologists say as well. All right, so with that, I will close. Okay, so before I open to questions, close to 20 minutes, I want to quickly talk about Pyramid Valley International. All of you have been attending these master classes. Some of you probably been attending earlier, and some of you, this is your first master class. Nevertheless, Pyramid Valley International has been established 17 years ago. It's a 30-acre campus on the outskirts of Bangalore. And you must have seen the videos of Pyramid Valley. I might have shared with some of you, or you must have seen it on the YouTube channel before or after this program. It's a sprawling amazing campus, which is where fortunately I am in right now. So it's a sprawling campus, primarily with the mission of promoting three things. Number one is Anapanasati meditation. Number two, vegetarianism. And number three is spiritual science, the inner science, the inner transformation, right? And these are all centered around, we use pyramid energy as a tool to amplify all these, right? And that is why this house is one of the largest pyramids solely built for meditation. Fortunately, I and my family have been associated with the with this project since the time it was started around 2003. So it houses a huge pyramid that enables close to 5,000 people to sit at a time, and we've done that in the past, right? And then there are conference rooms, conference facilities available for people to conduct training. We do a lot of spiritual science classes, and there are close to 7 or 8 meditation spots across the campus. There is a pyramid, a mega pyramid we call, there is this Akhanda Dhyana pyramids where someone can come and sit for 24 hours. It's a small cabin where you can sit for 24 hours. When people have sat there for 24 hours, obviously taking their bio breaks. So they sit there doing meditation, 12 hours, 20 hours, whatever, right? So that is, we call Akhanda Dhyana, prolonged meditation thing. And then we have different high energy meditation spots. We have a Zen garden, we have an open air amphitheater, and we have a rock garden. There are different places around it. So we do a lot of retreats. Hopefully once you open up, we'll do a retreat. And the beauty or uniqueness of this place is, instead of spending time in a room or in a couple of rooms doing meditation, as part of that 7-day retreat, we call it as Dhyana Sadhana Saptaham, they get to use all these meditation spots at different times of the day. And the only thing that they do is stay in silence, meditate, and then at least part of those days, they completely stay only on a liquid diet, on a specified liquid diet, which is detoxifying. So it's basically detoxifying your body and fasting your mind. That's what they do in that retreat. So we do a lot of those retreats. And then a lot of these spiritual science classes, like these master classes, primarily to help and aid people in their inner journey and inner transformation, right? So we do all that. We're completely a charitable institution, non-profit organization, completely driven by donations and by people who come and stay here for and pay for their accommodation. Right? Outside of the retreats, also a lot of people come in and stay here. It's almost like a spiritual retreat or a vacation. So they come in here, and then we have world-class accommodation, different types of accommodation facilities, including dormitories and star class rooms. So all these facilities are available for people to take care, completely driven by charitable and contributions from people like all of you. And as the managing trustee of this Pyramid Valley International, I'd want to appeal. Okay, so I want to appeal, make a humble appeal for any charitable, generous contributions to continue maintaining and managing this valley, especially during this downtime, right? Especially during this lockdown time, we are not yet fully open. So we do have a staff of around 50 people. We do this online classes, and there are people who take care of maintaining the facility. So any amount of contributions from each one of you is welcome. You can go to our website, pyramidvalley.org/donate. There is a donate page on our website, which should have the information for you to how to make your payments. And please let your friends know about these master classes. And hopefully once we open, we will warmly welcome you. Thank you for your generous contributions, and please contribute to the cause of spreading meditation and spiritual science and vegetarianism all over the world through this wonderful facility. But please do visit this place as soon as we let you know that it is open. Thanks very much. I enjoyed it. And it, as always, whenever we teach, we also learn a lot. I also learned a lot, and hope to put a lot of those things into practice, or at least those things that I've not already done. All right. Thank you very much. And it was great talking to you and having you on this masterclass platform from Pyramid Valley. Thank you.